We are experiencing a very unprecedented situation caused by COVID-19. We know that more than 2 million people got infected by this deadly virus and more than 1.25 lakh people have been killed by this COVID-19. This is the biggest threat in the modern times to the humankind. So in this pressing situation, in this crisis period, let us all stand united in our thought and action. Let us fight the battle against COVID-19 successfully and let us bounce back to the normal through our concerted, coordinated efforts. We will sincerely follow the guidelines given by the health experts and the government to win this war against COVID-19. For UPSC aspirants preparing very seriously for prelims examination 2020, Smart Leaders IAS is coming out with an online crash course on current affairs for prelims 2020. Current affairs is a very important segment in the prelims examination, not just in prelims examination but also in the mains as well as interview. Current affairs is a very inevitable component. In prelims examination, more than 30 to 40% of the questions are coming from current affairs. So to effectively tackle these 30 to 40 questions out of 100 questions in prelims examination, we are coming out with an online crash course on current affairs. Even though this is a crash course, we will ensure that all the topics important for 2020 prelims will be covered in detail. We are following an approach called as fruit to root approach. The current affairs news which you are seeing is only a fruit, and every fruit is having a root. Questions in prelims examination can be anything from the fruit to the root. So to help you answer the question very easily, this crash course on current affairs by Smart Leaders IAS will immensely better your preparation. We hope that this current affairs crash course will empower your prelims preparation for this year 2020. Stay tuned to our YouTube channel for this online crash course. Today video 1 will be published. Kindly watch the video, take notes, and regularly hereafter new videos on current affairs topics will be uploaded in our YouTube channel. We believe that this will be definitely helping you for cracking your prelims examination. Thank you, friends.
Hello, dear friends. Welcome to our crash course on current affairs for the prelims examination 2020. The first set of topic which we will be covering is under international news. We have categorized international news into 4 subtopics. One is the regional grouping, which will be taken up first. Some 40 regional groupings are very important for this year prelims. We'll be having a very detailed discussion on the 40 regional groupings. Second set of topics will be international organizations. Third would be India and neighbors. And fourth will be international news. So we have said that we have categorized some 40 important topics under regional groupings. The first regional grouping which we'll be taking up for the discussion now is Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Shanghai Cooperation Organization came in the news because the summit with the head of the states, 19th summit with the head of the states, took place in June 2019. This summit came out with a declaration called as Bishkek Declaration. This summit took place in Bishkek, which is why the declaration is called as Bishkek Declaration. Bishkek is the capital of the country called as Kyrgyzstan in Central Asia. The next summit with the head of the states, that is the 20th summit, will take place in July 2020 in Russia in a place called as Saint Petersburg. We have said that 2019 summit came out with Bishkek declaration. Bishkek is the capital of Kyrgyzstan. In this map, we'll be seeing how Kyrgyzstan is surrounded by these countries: Kazakhstan, China, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. These are the 4 bordering countries of Kyrgyzstan. In the prelims examination, they are asking you this bordering country type of questions. So whenever you read a country which came in the news, you must have to see the political map of the country to understand how the country is bordered by other countries. So bordering countries become very important for prelims questions. The Prime Minister of India, who attended the BISEC summit, he came out with his vision for the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This vision is highlighted by the Prime Minister under the acronym called as HEALTH. HEALTH means cooperation on all the six areas. HEALTH stands for number one, health cooperation, number two, economic cooperation, number three, alternative energy, number four, literature and culture, number five, terrorism free society, number six, humanitarian cooperation. There is a parallel meeting which is taking place along with the summits. That meeting is called as Council of Head of the Government. Annual meeting it is like the summit. There is a meeting of the Council of Head of the Government. This meeting of the Council of Head of the Government took place in November 2019 in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. And for the first time, India is going to host the first, for the first time, India is going to host in 2020 the meeting of the Council of Head of the Government. So this is why it is very, very important. In 2020, for the first time, India is going to host the meeting of the Council of the Head of the Government. So this is important for this year prelims. First time India is hosting this meeting of the Council of Head of the Government. I repeat, there is a summit which is taking place, and there is also a meeting of the Council of Head of the Government which is taking place annually. The Council of the Head of the Government meeting, that is the 19th SEO Head of the Government Council meeting, is going to be hosted by India for the first time in 2020. So this is important. Now there are some basic informations which you have to know when you read Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It was called as Shanghai 5 when five countries on April 26, 1996, they signed a treaty to deepen the military trust in the border regions. So this meeting took place, or the treaty was signed in this place called as Shanghai, which is why it is called as Shanghai 5. Why it is called 5? Because five countries signed the treaty: China, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan. These are the five countries which signed the treaty on the deepening of the military trust in the border regions in 1996. Then the Shanghai 5 countries, next year, April 1997, they signed another treaty called as Treaty on Reduction of Military Forces in the Border Regions at Moscow. So the Shanghai 5 countries, they only initially formed this grouping. Later, 2001, Uzbekistan joined the grouping, and this got renamed as Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So Shanghai 5 became Shanghai Cooperation Organization with the addition of Uzbekistan in 2001. So formal launching of SCO will be in 2001. Even though the other istans are present in Central Asia as members of SCO, one istan which is not present is Turkmenistan. So Turkmenistan is not a member. Other istans in Central Asia, they are the members, but not Turkmenistan. Who among the following countries are not the members of the SCO may be a question asked in prelims. So you can be very well easily able to attempt this question, because Turkmenistan, other istans like Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, they are the members of SCO, but not Turkmenistan. There are four observers: Afghanistan, Belarus, Iran and Mongolia. India and Pakistan, they were earlier observers. They got elevated as full members in the 2017 Astana summit. India, Pakistan, they became the 7th and the 8th members since 2017. So initially it was Shanghai 5, then Uzbekistan. Initially it was Shanghai 5, then Uzbekistan got added. Shanghai 5 became SCO. Further, 7th and 8th members are India and Pakistan, who got included as full members. Earlier they were observers, they got included as full members in the SCO by June 2017 during the Astana summit. So totally there are 8 members in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. There are two official languages, one is Chinese and the other is Russian. The Secretariat of Shanghai Cooperation Organization is not in Shanghai, it is present in Beijing. This is a very important point which has to be noted. Though the name says Shanghai Cooperation Organization, but SCO is not headquartered in Shanghai, rather it is headquartered in Beijing. There is a very important organ of SCO which is very instrumental to fight against terrorism, that organization is called as, or that organ is called as, a regional anti-terrorist structure. In June 2004, during the Tashkent summit, this RATS, RATS, regional anti-terror structure of SU was created with headquarters in Tashkent, that is in Uzbekistan. It's a permanent organ of SU. It was formed against three important evils called terrorism, separatism and extremism. The head of the RATS is elected every 3 years. Tashkent is the headquarters of SU's permanent organ called as RATS. So where is Tashkent? Tashkent is the capital of Uzbekistan. Uzbekistan is surrounded by Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan and Afghanistan. So border of Uzbekistan or Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan and Turkmenistan. And Tashkent is the capital of Uzbekistan, in which the RATS headquarters is situated. March 2019, the 34th meeting of the RATS Council took place in Tashkent. And this is very, very important, the point which we are going to speak now. The first joint military exercise of SEO named SARI ARKA Anti-Terror 2019 took place in Kazakhstan in a region called as SARI ARKA region. So this is the first joint exercise, military exercise of SEO, SARI ARKA Anti-Terror 2019. The SARI ARKA is a grassland in Kazakhstan. Where is Kazakhstan? Kazakhstan is here. Kazakhstan is bordered by Russia, Turkmenistan. Then you see Caspian Sea also borders Kazakhstan. Caspian Sea is bordering Kazakhstan. Then Uzbekistan. Then you have Kyrgyzstan. Then you have China. So these are the bordering countries. Russia, then Kazakhstan is bordered by Russia, then Caspian Sea, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan and China. These are the bordering countries of Kazakhstan. India is going to gain a lot because of SEO. Look at the significance which SEO has for India. India needs so much of energy security, and Caspian Sea hydrocarbon is very, very important for India to fuel its 8% growth rate. So 25% of oil and 50% of natural gas is present in Central Asia. India do not have a direct border with Central Asia. So through SEO, India can easily access the Central Asian energy reserves. Kazakhstan is very famous for uranium. Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan has abundant resources of gold. Look at the bilateral trade. Our trade with Central Asia is very, very low. See, annual trade of India, Central Asia is just $2 billion. But look at the China, Central Asia annual trade, which is 25 times more than that of India, Central Asia bilateral trade. So $50 billion is the trade between India, between China and Central Asia, whereas $2 billion is the trade between India and Central Asia. India-Russia trade is $10 billion. It is very, very low compared to its potential. But look at the India-Russia trade is very small compared to China-Russia trade. Look at, it is 10 times bigger than India-Russia trade. China-Russia trade is 10 times bigger than India-Russia trade. Our trade with Russia is just $10 billion. China trade with Russia is $100 billion.
The second topic is on Eurasian Economic Union. Eurasian Economic Union came in the news because Russia pushes India's entry into the Eurasian Economic Union. Russia is strongly supporting India's membership into the Eurasian Economic Union. Also, India and Eurasian Economic Union are discussing the possibility of signing a free trade agreement to boost the bilateral trade between India and Eurasia. Already, Eurasian Economic Union has signed free trade agreements with Serbia and Singapore. Eurasian Economic Union declared that by 2025, they'll come out with a financial common market. Now we'll see who are the members of the Eurasian Economic Union. The countries are marked in blue color. They are the members of the Eurasian Economic Union: Russia, Belarus, Armenia, Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. These are the five member countries of Eurasian Economic Union. Now we'll see some background information related to Eurasian Economic Union. In December 1991, three countries, Russia, Kazakhstan and Belarus, they signed an agreement called as Belavesa Accord. What is Belavesa? Belavesa is nothing but a place in Belarus. So in this place in Belarus called as Belavesa, three countries, Russia, Kazakhstan and Belarus, signed an agreement called as Belavesa Accord. This Belavesa Accord, it founded the Commonwealth of Independent States. So three countries, Russia, Kazakhstan, Belarus, in 1991, by Belavesa Accord, founded the Commonwealth of Independent States. Later, more number of member countries joined this Commonwealth of Independent State. So as of now, there are 9 member countries of Commonwealth of Independent States. They are Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Moldova, Russia, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. So it started as a 3 member country, Commonwealth of Independent States. Later it added more members to become 9 member state, Commonwealth of Independent States. There is one country called as Turkmenistan, who is an associate member of Commonwealth of Independent States. Then in 1996, the three countries signed a treaty on increased integration in the economic and humanitarian fields. And this 1996 treaty laid the first foundation for the economic convergence amongst the three countries. In 2001, there was another treaty signed called as Treaty on Eurasian Economic Community by the three countries. Later, in 2007, the three countries, Kazakhstan, Belarus and Russia, they created Customs Union. After 3 years, in 2010, Eurasian Customs Union declared that they'll remove all the customs borders between each other after July 2011. So Customs Union will remove all the custom barrier among the three countries, Belarus, Kazakhstan and Russia, after July 2011. In 2012, Eurasian Economic Space was founded by the same three countries, Belarus, Kazakhstan and Russia. In 2012, Eurasian Economic Commission was founded by the three countries, which are the governing body of the Eurasian Economic Space. This Eurasian Commission is having its headquarters in Moscow. On May 29, 2014, there was a treaty signed by the three countries, same three countries, Kazakhstan, Belarus and Russia, called as Treaty on the Eurasian Economic Union. This treaty came into force on January 1, 2015. And January 1, 2015, Eurasian Economic Union therefore came into force. This Eurasian Economic Union was the idea given by the first president of Kazakhstan. His name is Nursultan Nazarbayev. He was the president of Kazakhstan from April 1992 to March 2019. In March 2019, Nursultan Nazarbayev, he resigned from the post of the president of Kazakhstan. So new members later got included. They are in Jan 2015, Armenia. In August 2015, Kyrgyzstan. So originally, three founder members, Kazakhstan, Belarus, Russia. Later, two other members got added. They are Armenia and Kyrgyzstan. We'll see in the map the 5 countries. Russia, already we have seen. Once again, we'll see Russia, Belarus, Kazakhstan, Armenia, Kyrgyzstan. These are the 5 members of Eurasian Economic Union. Armenia is the only country of the Eurasian Economic Union having no common border with other member states of the Union. So, the only country which is not having any border with the other members of Eurasian Economic Union is Armenia. In this map, we'll see where is Armenia located. Armenia is bordered by the following countries: Turkey, then you have Iran, then you have Azerbaijan, then Georgia. So these are the countries which border the country called Armenia. So Armenia is bordered by these 4 countries. I repeat, Turkey, Iran, Azerbaijan, Georgia, they border Armenia. and to the north of Armenia we have this Black Sea. Next topic is on Greater Eurasian Partnership. This Greater Eurasian Partnership is an idea given by the President of Russia, Putin. So this was an idea floated by the President of Russia, Putin. He wanted to include India, Iran, South Korea, Japan, and the Asian powers to dilute the Chinese power. So this is a containment China strategy of Putin, called as Greater Eurasian Partnership. Partnership will include Asian countries, Eurasian Economic Union, and Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So Eurasian Economic Union, ASEAN, and SEO, these are the three important groupings who will come together through this partnership proposal given by the President of Russia. Now we'll speak about the fourth topic, called as Collective Security Treaty Organization, CSTO. Why CSTO was in the news? On November 28, 2019, there was a session of CSTO Council held in Bishkek, which is the capital of Kyrgyzstan. This is the reason why CSTO came in the news. Now we'll discuss some basic information related to CSTO. In 1992, six countries, they signed a treaty called as Tashkent Treaty. They are Russia, Armenia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. These six countries, they signed a treaty called as Tashkent Treaty in 1992. Later, in 1993, three other countries, Azerbaijan, Belarus, and Georgia, they joined this Tashkent Treaty or Collective Security Treaty. Then in 1994, CST, that is Collective Security Treaty, came into force. So in 1992, six countries signed the treaty called as Tashkent Treaty or Collective Security Treaty. In 1993, three other members joined this CST, and by April 20, 1994, this Collective Security Treaty came into force. By 2002, the founder countries, six countries who signed the Tashkent Treaty, they agreed to create CSTO as a military alliance. Collective Security Treaty Organization will be made as a military alliance according to the founder countries of CSTO. They made this declaration in 2002. So CST, that is Collective Security Treaty, became Collective Security Treaty Organization. The main intention of this Collective Security Treaty Organization is to defend the member countries collectively against any external aggression. So that is the main intention, to protect the member countries from any external aggression. The CSTO is seen as a Eurasian counterpart of North Atlantic Treaty Organization, because North Atlantic Treaty Organization is mostly headed by the capitalist bloc, and CSTO is a counter to this NATO, which is headed by the communist bloc. So communist bloc of CSTO versus capitalist bloc of. Now we'll discuss which are the countries which walked out of CSTO. Three countries walked out of CSTO, later rejoined. Azerbaijan, it withdrew in 1994, but later rejoined in 1999. Georgia walked out in 1994, rejoined in 1999. Uzbekistan, twice it walked out and twice it rejoined. First time in 1994, it walked out of CSTO, but in 1999, it rejoined. Second time in 2006, it walked out of CSTO, but in 2012, it rejoined. There are two observers of CSTO. One is Afghanistan and the second is Serbia. The fifth topic is on North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO. Why NATO was in news? NATO was in news because of inclusion of a new member called as North Macedonia. On 27th of March 2020, North Macedonia becomes the new member of NATO. Also, on December 3rd, 2009, there was a meeting of the head of the state and the government of NATO in London to commemorate the 70th anniversary of NATO. NATO was founded in 1949. In 2019, NATO was celebrating its 70th anniversary. Some background information about NATO. In 1947, there was a treaty called as Dunkirk Treaty signed by Britain and France. These two countries, they entered into a defense agreement with each other at a place called as Dunkirk in France, which is why it is called as Dunkirk Treaty. Then March 1948, there was a treaty signed by five countries at Brussels called as Treaty of Brussels. The five countries are Belgium, France, Luxembourg, Netherlands and UK. These five countries signed the Brussels Treaty in March 1948. The main intention of this treaty is to protect the five countries against German or Soviet aggression. After World War II was over, there was a possibility of the German or Soviet aggression of the European countries, which is why Belgium Treaty or the Brussels Treaty was signed to protect the countries against the German or Soviet aggression. On April 4, 1949, apart from the five Brussels countries, seven countries including US, Canada, Portugal, Italy, Norway, Denmark and Iceland, so totally 12 countries, they formally founded this NATO. Brussels five countries plus seven other countries. I repeat, Brussels five countries plus seven other countries including US, Canada, Portugal, Italy, Norway, Denmark and Iceland, they founded this NATO on April 4th, 1949. NATO is an intergovernmental military alliance between three UN Security Council's permanent members like US, UK and France. Macedonia entry. Republic of Macedonia changed its name from Republic of Macedonia to Republic of North Macedonia to join this NATO as well as European Union. Why Macedonia should change its name? The name change was warranted because Greece was opposing the use of the name called as Republic of Macedonia. Why Greece opposed the use of the name Macedonia? Greece opposed the use of the name Macedonia without a geographical qualifier like North Macedonia. So Greece wanted that Macedonia should change its name from Macedonia to North Macedonia, which is why Greece was opposing the earlier attempts of Macedonia to enter NATO or European Union without any name change. There are two official candidates approved by NATO. They are Bosnia and Herzegovina. NATO also says there are two aspiring members. One is Georgia and another is Ukraine. So there are two official candidates, Bosnia and Herzegovina. So there are two official candidates, Bosnia and Herzegovina, and two aspiring candidates, Georgia and Ukraine. In this map, we will see the location of Macedonia. Macedonia is surrounded by Serbia, Kosovo, Albania, and Bulgaria. Use of the term Macedonia means the entire Macedonia, according to Greece. Greece says the western, central, eastern Macedonia do not become a part of Macedonia. So, Macedonia name should be only specific to the northern part of Macedonia. Therefore, it was compelling Macedonia to change its name from Macedonia to Northern Macedonia. Since Northern Macedonia name was the new name of Macedonia, Greece is not having any issue for including North Macedonia as a member of NATO. There is an alliance which NATO is having with countries who are not the members of NATO. Those countries who are non-members of NATO, they are called as global partners of NATO. These are the countries who are the global partners of NATO, called as Afghanistan, Australia, Colombia, Iraq, Japan, Republic of Korea, Mongolia, New Zealand and Pakistan. So these are the countries who are not the members of NATO, but they are global partners of NATO. In the year 2018, Colombia becomes NATO's first global partner in Latin America. However, Article 5 of NATO will not apply to Colombia. Article 5 apply only to full-fledged members of NATO. It will not apply to the global partner. Now, what is Article 5? Article 5 of NATO treaty says that an attack on one member state is considered as an attack on all the member states. This provision of Article 5 does not apply to the global partner. It applies only to the 30 full-fledged members of NATO. Article 5 was declared only once so far, on September 12, 2001, following the 9/11 attack on the World Trade Center in US. So only once Article 5 was invoked, that too after the Twin Tower attack on September 11. After the Twin Tower was attacked by Al-Qaeda and its allies, on October 7, 2001, America led an operation against Afghanistan to crack global terrorism, codenamed Operation Enduring Freedom. So Operation Enduring Freedom is American-led Afghanistan invasion in 2001 to crack down the global terrorists. US government has launched a war on terrorism. A global war on terrorism was launched by US and its allies under the codename Operation Enduring Freedom. From 2003 to December 2014, NATO was leading the UN-mandated International Security Assistance Force, that is ISAF, in Afghanistan. So ISAF was mandated by UN Security Council Resolution 1386 in December 2001, as envisaged by Bonn Agreement. The purpose of ISAF is to give security cover to Afghanistan. ISAF is headed by NATO, but ISAF has its troop coming from non-NATO members as well. Jan 2015, NATO launched the Resolute Support Mission to train, advise and assist the Afghan security forces and the institution. So Resolute Support Mission is launched by NATO in Jan 2015 to train, advise and assist the Afghan security forces and other institutions. In this map, we will see how Afghanistan is surrounded by the countries like Iran, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Pakistan. These are the bordering countries of Afghanistan: Iran, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Pakistan. What do you mean by NATO ally-like status? Why NATO ally-like status came in the news? The US Senate passed a bill to give India the same status as that of NATO allies. Earlier, US has accorded this NATO ally-like status to countries like South Korea, Japan, and Australia. This new bill will be a part of the National Defense Authorization Act 2020. What are the benefit of giving NATO ally-like status to India? This National Defense Authorization Act will ensure that the US State Department will treat India as a non-member NATO ally for the purpose of Arms Export Control Act. India, even though not a member of NATO, will be accorded the same status as that of a NATO ally by America because of this legislation. This is very, very important for India with respect to its arms trade with that of America. Earlier in 2001, Pakistan also received the status of the major non-NATO ally from that of US. But however, the US has downgraded Pakistan's status of major non-NATO ally in 2017 because Pakistan was harboring terrorism. It was supporting Osama bin Laden and it was financing terrorism. Due to this actions of Pakistan, US downgraded Pakistan's status as a major non-NATO ally in the year 2017. Not only that, US suspended more than $1.66 billion worth of military aid which was given to Pakistan. The sixth topic is on CICA, that is Conference on Interaction and Confidence Building Measures in Asia. It came in the news because the Foreign Minister of India attended the 5th CICA Summit in Tajikistan. June 2019, Foreign Minister of India Dr. Jai Shankar attended the 5th CICA Summit in Dushanbe, Tajikistan, which is why this came in the news. Now in this map, we'll see which are the countries which border Tajikistan. Tajikistan is bordered by Uzbekistan, then Kyrgyzstan, then China and Afghanistan. So these are the four countries which border Tajikistan. I repeat, Tajikistan is bordered by Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan and China. Now we'll see some background information related to CICA. October 1992, for the first time, the Kazakhstan President Nur Sultan Nazarbayev gave the proposal of CICA. In the second topic on Eurasian Economic Union, we have seen that Eurasian Economic Union was first proposed by the same person, Kazakhstan first President Nur Sultan. So CICA was also for the first time proposed by Nur Sultan, like that of Eurasian Economic Union. CICA is an intergovernmental forum for promoting peace, security and stability. CICA consists of 27 member states, which includes India, Pakistan, China, Russia and others. So India, Pakistan, China, they are members of this CICA. There are 8 observer states including US and Japan.
The 7th topic is AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Some background information about AIIB. AIIB was established in December 2015 and in Jan 2016 it commenced its operation. The headquarters of AIIB is in Beijing. How many members are there? There are 57 founding members of AIIB, including India. So India is a founder member of AIIB. There are 102 approved members of AIIB. And who can become the members of the bank? AIIB members can come from World Bank or Asian Development Bank. So any member of World Bank, any member of Asian Development Bank can become the member of AIIB. There are two types of members, therefore. One is regional members, another is non-regional members. This membership question was already asked in UPSC in the previous year. 3 years back, this question was asked regarding the number of members of AIIB. Even non-sovereign entities can become the member of AIIB. Sovereign wealth funds, state-owned enterprises of the member countries can also join this AIIB. Now come to the shareholding. China has 32% of shareholding in this AIIB. Next is India. Third largest shareholder is Russia, Germany. So China has the largest shareholding, that is 32%. Regional members have 72% of the voting power, whereas non-regional members have 25% of the voting power. So this is how AIIB is not equally owned by the countries. 32% of ownership is in the hands of the Chinese. AIIB has approved 5 projects in India so far. And which are the 5 projects? The first project was Bangalore Metro Rail Project. Then secondly, Transmission System Strengthening Project. then Gujarat Rural Road Project, then India Infrastructure Fund, and fifthly, Andhra Pradesh 24/7 Power for All Project. So these are the five projects for which AIIB has given approval for financial support. AIIB is investing $200 million in National Infrastructure Investment Fund, NIIF. Now what is NIIF? NIIF was already asked in prelims question in the past years. NIIF is an Indian government backed entity established to provide long-term capital to the country's infrastructure. So it is a financial entity which will be helping in the infrastructure development of India. NIIB was proposed in 2015 budget. So December 2016, it was set up as an alternate investment fund, AIF. The corpus of this NIIF is 40,000 crores. This was the question already asked in prelims in the UPSC examination. They have given in the statement the corpus of NIIF is 4 lakh crore. Instead of 40,000 crore, they have given in the statement 4 lakh crore. So since they have added 10 extra, this statement was wrong, and some students did not focus on this number, which is why they could not make the statement correct. So NIIF is a financial instrument to support the infrastructure development of India, and it is having a corpus of 40,000 crores. Look at the shareholding. Indian government has 49% of stake in this NIIF. The rest 51% can be invested by the foreign and domestic investors. So this is a very important topic, NIIF. Eighth topic is Asian Development Bank. Now we'll speak about some important background information related to Asian Development Bank. Asian Development Bank was in the news because on 11th April 2020, the ADB president Asakawa assured that India will be supported ADB to fight against COVID-19 pandemic. So they have assured a support of $2.2 billion to India, which is around 16,500 crores of rupees, Indian rupees, equivalent to USD 2.2 billion will be given as an assistance by ADB to India to fight against COVID. Some basic information about ADB. It was established in 1966 December. It has 31 founder countries including India. So this is very important. Any regional grouping, first we should understand whether India is a founder member or not. So 31 founder members including India. AIIB, India is a founder member. In the same way, ADB also, India is a founder member. So from 31, the number of members increased to 68, out of which 49 are from Asia Pacific and 19 countries are outside Asia Pacific. Who and all can become the member of ADB? ADB members can be coming from member countries of UNSCAP, United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia Pacific members, can join this ADB as a member. Where is the headquarters of ADB? It is headquartered in a place called as Mandalayong, which is a city in Manila, Philippines. ADB is an official observer of United Nations, and the bank is funding TAPI project, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India project, is supported by financially ADB. In fact, China does not want the funding mechanism to be given by ADB, because according to China, who is having maximum share in ADB? It's Japan. Therefore, the main reason for floating AIIB, in which China is having major shareholding, is to counter this ADB. Since ADB is funding TAPI project, China is not happy with this TAPI project. right? So even America is not happy with TAPI project, and TAPI project we'll take up in the next topic. Ninth topic therefore is Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India gas line project. This gas pipeline project came in the news because in September 2019 Pakistan assured Turkmenistan that the tension rising between India and Pakistan will not affect negatively TAPI project. Why tension was increasing in this period? Because India abrogated Article 370, which spiked the tension between India and Pakistan. 370 article was giving special status to Jammu Kashmir. Indian government scrapped this Article 370. So this spiked tension between India and Pakistan. However, the tension will not negatively affect the TAPI project. That is what the assurance coming from the Pakistan end. The pipeline is expected to commence its operation in 2020. So this year, this pipeline is expected to commence its operation. Some background information. Now look at this map. This pipeline is going to connect Fazalika in Punjab. It will go to Multan. From where it will go to Quetta. Then it will go to Kandahar in Afghanistan. Then Herat province in Afghanistan. Finally, Galinish gas field. So actually this is the gas field in Turkmenistan, Galinish gas field. This Galinish gas field is only supplying, is going to supply gas to India via Afghanistan and Pakistan, which is why this pipeline project is called as TAPI project. So from Turkmenistan, that is Galinish gas field, the gas will come to Afghanistan, then Pakistan and India. So this is a very, very important project which will help in the realization of energy security for India. It's a 10 billion worth project. This project is a 10 billion worth project, and this project is having this much of length, 1814 kilometer pipeline project. It is supposed to carry 33 billion cubic meter of Turkmenistan gas to South Asia for 30 years. So the project is for 30 years Turkmenistan is going to supply gas to South Asia, including Afghanistan, Pakistan and India. India and Pakistan will purchase 42% of the total gas produced. Afghanistan will purchase around 16% of the gas produced. Apart from this, Afghanistan also will be receiving $400 million every year as a transit fee. So Afghanistan will definitely economically get benefited by this project, so as India and Pakistan. In December 2010, a gas pipeline framework agreement was signed by the four petroleum ministers of four countries. Subsequently, in May 2012, bilateral gas sale agreement was signed by the four countries. And in February 2018, the ceremony marking the beginning of construction of the Afghanistan-Pakistan section of the pipeline was held. So Afghanistan-Pakistan section was inaugurated. The construction was inaugurated in the year 2018. However, India is having some problem with this TAPI pipeline project because of the price. India wanted to renegotiate the price of the natural gas coming from Turkmenistan. India says that the final consumer will have to pay a price of around $13 per million British thermal unit of the gas, which is a very, very heavy price after adding the local taxes and transportation charges. So hike in the price of the natural gas is unacceptable to India, and therefore India wanted to renegotiate the natural gas price. 10th topic is on BRICS. BRICS came in the news because November 2019, 11th BRICS summit was held in Brazil, in a place called as Brasilia. So they came out with a declaration called as Brasilia Declaration, and the theme of this Brazil summit was economic growth for an innovative future. Economic growth for an innovative future is the theme of this 11th BRICS summit, which was held in Brasilia. This year, 12th BRICS summit will be held in 2020 in Russia, in a place called as St. Petersburg. So, July 2020, the 12th BRICS summit is going to take place in Russia, in St. Petersburg. Some background information related to BRICS. In 2001, BRICS was an acronym coined by Goldman Sachs chief. His name is Jim O'Neill, who is a British economist. He said that four countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China, if they could cooperate economically, they will even surpass the economy of the G7 countries by 2030. So this is a potential grouping which was initially proposed by Goldman Sachs chief Jim O'Neill in 2001. Subsequently, in 2006, official formation of BRICS took place. Four countries officially joined this BRICS forum. They created the BRICS forum. The first formal summit of BRICS took place in 2009 in Russia, in a place called as Yekaterinburg. This was already asked in prelims question regarding the first summit of BRICS. The first summit of BRICS took place in June 2009 in Yekaterinburg in Russia. In 2010, South Africa became the fifth member, so BRIC became. So, in 2010, South Africa became the fifth member of the BRIC, thereby BRIC became BRICS with the addition of South Africa. Since 2009, every year BRICS summit is taking place annually. The sixth summit is very important because in July 2014, which took place in Fortaleza, Brazil, the sixth summit came out with two important initiatives. One is New Development Bank, another is CRA, Contingency Reserve Arrangement. So Fortaleza declaration was already asked in UPSC prelim. They asked Fortaleza declaration is connected to which among the following organization? BRICS is the answer. Very, very simple question they have asked in the previous year about Fortaleza declaration. So Fortaleza declaration, which took place in Brazil, July 2014 during the sixth summit, came out with two important institutions. One is the New Development Bank, another is Contingency Reserve Arrangement. 11th BRICS summit took place in Brasilia, which is why it was in the news. India hosted BRICS summit two times so far. One is 2016, another is 2012. So 2016-2012, two times India hosted the BRICS summit. Come to New Development Bank. In the fourth BRICS summit, which was held in New Delhi, there was a talk about New Development Bank. So the foundation stone of New Development Bank was laid in the fourth BRICS summit, which took place in New Delhi in 2012. The main objective of this New Development Bank is to provide infrastructure financial support to the BRICS countries. So the main intention is to give loan to develop the infrastructure and sustainable development projects in the BRICS countries. July 2014 at Fortaleza, Brazil, New Development Bank was formally established. So the formal establishment of NDB is attributable to Fortaleza declaration. How much is the authorized capital of NDB? $100 billion is the authorized capital of NDB. Where is NDB located? NDB is located in Shanghai. What about the shareholding? All five countries have equal shareholding in the NDB. This is not like AIIB, where China has 32% of the shareholding. K.V. Kamath of India was the first president of NDB. NDB has not given loan to any of the outside countries. So NDB has disbursed loan only to the member countries, that is the BRICS countries. So far, $5 billion loan has been disbursed to the member countries by NDB. Next is about contingents. Next is about Contingent Reserve Arrangement, CRA. NDB is to give long-term loan to develop the infrastructure, whereas CRA is to give short-term loan to develop, whereas CRA is to give short-term loan to resolve the balance of payment crisis. NDB is giving loan for development of the infrastructure, capital infrastructure. So it is a long-term loan compared to that of CRA, which is giving short-term loan to resolve the balance of payment crisis. As already we have told, July 2014, the idea of CRA got mooted in Fortaleza. So that in 2015, it was formally established in the 7th BRICS Summit in UFA. So NDB was established in Fortaleza through Fortaleza Declaration, whereas in 2015, next year, CRA was established in the 7th BRICS Summit, which took place in UFA in Russia. From October 2016 onwards, CRA started functioning. What is the contribution which CRA is getting from the member countries? CRA will have a corpus of $100 billion, out of which $41 billion will come from China. So China is giving maximum contribution to CRA. $41 billion will be given by China. India, Brazil, Russia, all the three will give $18 billion. Now let us talk about the CRA's corpus. The corpus of CRA is $100 billion. $100 billion will come from the five member countries, not equally, unequally. China is going to give maximum, that is $41 billion of the fund will come from China. Whereas India, Brazil, Russia, all the three will give $18 billion individually. Each will give $18 billion individually, that is India, Brazil, Russia. Whereas South Africa will give $5 billion to this CRA. So I repeat, two institutions of BRICS becomes very important. One is NDB, which is going to give long-term loan to the member countries to fund the capital infrastructure and the sustainable development projects. CRA is going to give loan for resolving the balance of payment crisis. So CRA is giving short-term loan and NDB gives long-term loan.
The 11th topic will be IPSA, India, Brazil and South Africa. In the year 2003, IPSA was founded formally by a declaration called as Brasilia Declaration to galvanize the South-South cooperation. IPSA is very important because it is running a very important fund called as IPSA Fund. Through this IPSA Fund, a number of poverty alleviation programs, health related schemes are getting operationalized in least developed countries. IPSA Fund for Poverty Alleviation is very small fund. Every country, three countries annually contribute only to $1 million to this fund. This fund is managed by UN Office for South-South Cooperation. UN Office was founded by UNDP. Since 1974, UN Office for South-South Cooperation is hosted by UNDP. That is, UN Development Program is the host of UN Office for South-South Cooperation, which is only managing this IPSA fund. 62.4% of the IPSA fund is devoted to LDCs. So it is very important for the least developed countries, because this fund is immensely fruitful in the form of the poverty alleviation projects, health related schemes in the least developed countries. In this, we will find out where and all IPSA summits took place and when it took place. In the year 2006, the first IPSA summit was taking place in Brazil, in Brasilia. It came out with a declaration called as Brasilia Declaration. In the next year, 2007, the second summit took place in Shane in South Africa. Shanghai Declaration 2007 during the second IPSA summit. In the year 2008, the third summit took place in New Delhi. So, in 2008, third IPSA summit took place in New Delhi. So far, there is only one summit which was hosted by India, that too in 2008, the third IPSA summit. 2010, fourth summit took place in Brasilia, and fifth summit took place in 2011 in Shanghai. So twice summits have taken place in Brasilia, twice summits have taken place in Shanghai, only once New Delhi hosted the IPSA summit. During the 2018 June foreign ministers meeting, that is the second BRICS foreign ministers meeting in South Africa in a place called as Pretoria, IPSA came out with a declaration on the South-South cooperation. So IPSA declaration on South-South cooperation was made during the second BRICS foreign ministers meeting, which took place in 2018 in the place called as Pretoria in South Africa. 12th topic will be BIMSTEC. Why BIMSTEC is very, very important? BIMSTEC means Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. This is the full expansion of the acronym called as BIMSTEC. BIMSTEC is in news because in the year 2019, November, the first BIMSTEC conclave of ports took place in Visakhapatnam, which is why it came in the news. In 1997, four countries, that is Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka and Thailand, they went for a declaration called as Bangkok Declaration to create an economic cooperation. It is called as BIST-EC. B stands for Bangladesh, I for India, S for Sri Lanka and T for Thailand. So BIST-EC, it is founded by 1997, four countries, that is Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, Thailand, they went for a declaration called as Bangkok Declaration to create an economic cooperation. In 1997, Myanmar got added, so the forum became BIMSTEC. In 2004, two countries got added called as Nepal and Bhutan, and since 2004, the forum is called as BIMSTEC. Out of seven countries from BIMSTEC, five are from South Asia and two are from Southeast Asia. The five countries from South Asia are India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal and Bhutan. These are the countries belonging to SAARC. And these two countries, that is Myanmar and Thailand, they are from ASEAN. So BIMSTEC is the best platform for coordination and cooperation between two organizations. One is SAARC, another is ASEAN. BIMSTEC is having its permanent headquarters in Dhaka, Bangladesh. So far, these five summits have taken place. In 2004, first summit took place in Bangkok, Thailand. 2008, second summit took place in New Delhi. 2014, third summit took place in Naypyidaw in Myanmar. Fourth summit took place in 2018 in Kathmandu, Nepal. And fifth summit is going to take place in the year 2022 in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Now some information related to the fourth summit which took place in Kathmandu in 2018. In this summit only, there was a proposal to create BIMSTEC Development Fund with the help of voluntary contribution coming from the member countries. During the fourth summit, the countries in BIMSTEC, they welcomed Thailand's proposal of five pillars to increase the synergy amongst the BIMSTEC countries. So Thailand's proposal of five pillars to increase the synergy amongst BIMSTEC countries got welcomed during the fourth summit in Kathmandu. The five pillars proposed by Thailand are connectivity, number two, trade and investment, number three, people to people contact, number four, security, number five, science and technology. Next topic will be the 13th topic, Asia Pacific Trade Agreement. This is the 13th topic. APTA came in the news because Mongolia is going to become the 7th member of APTA. So far 6 members are there in APTA. Mongolia is going to become the 7th member of APTA, which is why APTA came in the news. The membership is open to all the developing countries. APTA is the only trade agreement between India and China which is currently in operation. So far, we have not signed a free trade agreement with China, even though China is the biggest trading partner of India. Now, some background information related to APTA. APTA has its origin in 1975 through an agreement called as Bangkok Agreement. Bangkok Agreement was signed because of the initiative taken by United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia Pacific. This UNSCAP is having its trade and development. This UNSCAP is having its trade and investment division in Bangkok, which is the headquarters or the secretariat of APTA. APTA is the oldest preferential trade agreement concluded amongst the developing countries in Asia Pacific. The 6 participating states of APTA are: number 1 Bangladesh, number 2 China, number 3 India, 4 Laos, number 5 South Korea, and number 6 Sri Lanka. So these are the 6 member countries of APTA, and 7th country is Mongolia, which is going to become the new member. That's why it came in the news. We should also know the basic difference between preferential trade agreement and free trade agreement. Preferential trade agreement is very narrow, whereas free trade agreement is very broader. Why PTA, that is preferential trade agreement, is narrow? Because it is intending to eliminate the duties on certain number of identified items. So the two countries will identify certain items on which there will be elimination of duties. So item based negotiation will take place between the countries signing PTA. But FTA is broader because it is intending to cut or eliminate the duties on most of the goods traded between the countries. Also, it will also help in the liberalization of norms which promotes the trade in goods, services, as well as investment. So this is why it is broader. It covers not only goods but also services as well as investment, whereas PTA is only targeting to reduce the duty on specific items which has been negotiated by the countries. So FTA therefore is broader than PTA. India announced that it will give tariff concession on 3142 items to the APTA countries, plus it will give special concession on 48 products for the least developed countries in the agreement called as Bangladesh and Laos. So these two countries called as LDC countries will get extra concession from India. Similarly, China also agreed to reduce or cut the tariff to zero level on 8549 goods which are originating in India, Bangladesh, Laos, South Korea, and Sri Lanka. But the main challenge is market access in agri commodities and pharma products. The agreement is not covering these things because they are irritations in the trade between the countries. So market access in agri commodities and pharma product has not been negotiated successfully, which is why it becomes a very important challenge in APTA. Next topic is 14th topic. The topic is on Caspian Sea Legal Status Breakthrough Treaty signed in 2018. Even though the classification which we have done is regional grouping, we are also covering some important regional agreements, right? So the Caspian Sea countries are, there are 5 countries: Russia, Iran, Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, and Turkmenistan. These are the 5 Caspian Sea countries. They have signed a very, very important treaty in 2018 called as Caspian Sea Legal Status Breakthrough Treaty. In this map, we'll see how Caspian Sea is bordered by the five countries: Russia, Azerbaijan, Iran, Turkmenistan, and Kazakhstan. These are the five Caspian Sea countries. They have signed a Caspian Sea legal status treaty in the year 2018. What is the main reason for signing the treaty? The reason is disputes, ongoing disputes amongst the Caspian Sea countries related to drilling of oil and natural gas. For example, countries like Iran, Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, they are fighting for ownership of several oil and gas fields in Caspian Sea. Also, Russia is not allowing Turkmenistan to lay a pipeline, which is 300 km gas pipeline, to Azerbaijan. Caspian Sea is having huge reserves of oil and natural gas. For example, 20 billion barrels of oil and 240 trillion cubic feet of natural gas is present in Caspian Sea. So it is a very rich source of energy. What this treaty says? The treaty says 15 nautical miles from the coastline will be sovereign water and exclusive economic zone, plus 10 nautical miles further can be used by the littoral states for fishing. So 25 nautical miles, first 15 nautical miles will be the sovereign water for the coastal country, and next 10 nautical miles will be open for fishing by the littoral country. This treaty also says each member nation, if they wanted to lay a pipeline, they need to get the consent only from the neighboring countries which are affected by the pipeline, not from all the Caspian Sea countries. Another important aspect of this treaty is this treaty will ensure that Caspian nations will not allow any foreign military presence. So US, NATO forces cannot deploy their forces on the Caspian water because of this treaty. 15th topic is on Ashgabat Agreement. Why Ashgabat Agreement is important? India has become a member of this Ashgabat Agreement. What are the benefit of India entering into this Ashgabat Agreement? In this map, we'll see how India can benefit out of this Ashgabat Agreement. India has no direct border with Afghanistan, so India cannot directly access Central Asia. Through Pakistan, India can get connected to Afghanistan, and from Afghanistan, India can get, through Pakistan, India can get connected to Afghanistan, and from Afghanistan, India can gain access to Central Asia. But this is not possible because of the hostile relation between India and Pakistan. So India has to explore new opportunity through Iran. India can get connected to Afghanistan through Iran. India can get connected to Central Asia. There was a question asked in the last year UPSC prelims examination. The question was on Chabahar port. Why India wanted the Chabahar port modernization in Iran? It is to circumvent Pakistan. That is the right answer, which was asked 2 years back in UPSC prelims. Now from Mumbai, India can get access to Iran through Bandar Abbas. Then we can get connected to Tehran. From Tehran, India can get connected to Central Asia. Similarly, from Tehran, India can go to Istanbul. From Istanbul, India can get connected to the European market. So this Ashgabat Agreement is a game changer because it is going to give a very good trade connectivity between India and Central Asia, India and Europe. This is why Ashgabat Agreement is very important for India. Some background information related to Ashgabat Agreement. Ashgabat is the capital city of Turkmenistan. The Ashgabat Agreement was signed on April 25, 2011 by the following countries: Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Iran, Oman, and Qatar. These five countries, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Iran, Oman, and Qatar, they signed this Ashgabat Agreement on April 25, 2011. This Ashgabat Agreement is establishing a transport and transit corridor between the countries in Persian Gulf and Central Asia. In 2013, Qatar withdrew from the agreement. In 2015, Kazakhstan joined the agreement. In 2016, agreement came into force. Turkmenistan is the depository state for the agreement. In 2016, Pakistan joined the Ashgabat Agreement. In 2018, India joined the Ashgabat Agreement. So, India is going to immensely benefit because of the Ashgabat Agreement. 16th topic is on International North-South Transport Corridor. This is a 7,200 km long multimodal network of ship, rail and road connectivity to move the freight between the countries like India, Iran, Afghanistan, Armenia, Azerbaijan and Russia. So this is a very, very important transport corridor which will benefit India a lot. Trade connectivity will be established between cities like Mumbai, Moscow, Tehran, Baku, Bandar Abbas, Astrakhan, Bandar Ansali, etc. Already trial runs were connected. Already dry runs of the two routes were conducted in 2014. The first dry run was conducted between Mumbai and Baku via Bandar Abbas. The second trial run was between Mumbai and Astrakhan through Bandar Abbas, Tehran and Bandar Ansali. This international north-south transport corridor will help synchronization with that of the Ashgabat Agreement. In this map, we'll see how a short route is provided by the International North-South Transport Corridor. The standard route is a very, very lengthy route. If we wanted to go from Mumbai to St. Petersburg, see how lengthy the route is. Now, through this International North-South Transport Corridor, India can easily get connected to Iran, then Azerbaijan, then Moscow. So this is a very, very short route, and this is why this corridor is very, very important. We have seen that how dry runs were conducted in 2014. Mumbai was connected to Bandar Abbas. Mumbai was connected to Azerbaijan. Mumbai was connected to Astrakhan. So dry runs were conducted to connect Mumbai with that of Iran, Azerbaijan, in 2014. The 17th topic is on IORA, Indian Ocean Rim Association. IORA came in the news because in November 2019, IORA Council of Ministers meeting took place in Abu Dhabi in UAE, which is why it came in news. In this meeting, they came out with a theme called as Promoting a Shared Destiny and a Path to Prosperity in Indian Ocean. This is the theme of the 2019 November meeting of the Council of Ministers, which was held in Abu Dhabi. For the year 2017-19, South Africa was the president or the chair of this IORA. From 2019-2021, UAE will be the chair assisted by Bangladesh. So, chair will be UAE from 2019-2021 and Bangladesh will be the assistant chair. A very important initiative of IORA is Blue Economy Initiative. In September 2015, in the first IORA Ministerial Blue Economy Conference, which was held in Mauritius, they came out with a Blue Economy Declaration. Later in May 2017, the second Blue Economy Conference was held on Financing Blue Economy. It was taking place in a place called as Jakarta, and therefore they came out with a declaration called as Jakarta Declaration on Blue Economy. The third IORA Blue Economy Conference took place in Dhaka in September 5, 2019. On September 5, 2019, the third IORA Blue Economy Conference was held in Dhaka. This is important because this is the first time Bangladesh is hosting the conference. For the first time, IORA Ministerial Conference was organized by Bangladesh on September 5, 2019. The theme of this third Blue Economy Conference was Promoting Sustainable Blue Economy, Making the Best Use of Opportunities from the Indian Ocean. That is the theme of the third Blue Economy Conference, which took place in Dhaka. Some background information related to IORA. In 1995, the vision for IORA was coming from the president of South Africa, Nelson Mandela, who visited India. During his visit, Mandela was speaking about IORA, and therefore IORA is the brainchild of the South African president Nelson Mandela in 1995. In 1997, IORA ARC was established as an intergovernmental organization, Indian Ocean Rim Association for Regional Cooperation. So 1997, IORA ARC was established as an intergovernmental body. It is having a secretariat in Eben in Mauritius. There are 22 members in this IORA. In 2018, Maldives was accepted as the 22nd member with the support of India. So Maldives became the 22nd member of IORA because of the support of India in 2018. These are the countries which are the members of IORA: Australia, Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, Seychelles, Comoros, Madagascar, Mauritius, South Africa, Mozambique, Tanzania, Kenya, Yemen, Oman, UAE, Iran. These are the members of IORA. Myanmar wanted to become a member of IORA, but Myanmar could not become because of opposition coming from South Africa. There are 10 dialogue partners of IORA, namely UK, US, China, Japan, Republic of Korea, Turkey, Egypt, France, Germany, and Italy. These are the dialogue partners of IORA. There are 6 important areas of cooperation outlined by IORA. That includes maritime security, trade and investment facilitation, fisheries management, disaster risk reduction, academic and scientific cooperation, tourism promotion, and cultural exchange. 18th topic is on Indian Ocean Dialogue. The Indian Ocean Dialogue is an initiative of Indian Ocean Rim for Association. It came in the news because in December 2019, the 6th Indian Ocean Dialogue took place in New Delhi. Indian Ocean Dialogue is a flagship initiative of Indian Ocean Rim Association. It was founded in 2013 during the 13th Council of Ministers meeting, Perth, Australia. So IOD is an initiative of IORA, and it was established in November 2013 during the 13th Council of Ministers meeting in Perth, Australia. Indian Ocean Dialogue. The first Indian Ocean Dialogue took place in 2014 in Kochi. It came out with a consensus called as Kochi Consensus. The second IOD took place in 2015 in Perth, Australia. Third one in 2016 in Pandang, Indonesia. Fourth in 2017 in Abu Dhabi, UAE. Fifth one in 2018 in Durban, South Africa. So why IOD came in the news? Because in December 2019, the 6th IOD took place in New Delhi. The theme of the 6th IOD, which took place in New Delhi, was Indo-Pacific, reimagining the Indian Ocean through an expanded geography. 19th topic is on APEC, Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation. APEC was in news because in November 2019, the 31st APEC summit was planned to take place in Chile's capital, Santiago. But this meeting was cancelled because of civil protests in Chile. Why people protested in Chile? People protested in Chile because of increase in Santiago metro subway fare, because of increased cost of living, and because of privatization and rising inequality. People of Chile went for civil protests, which is why APEC summit, 31st summit, which has to take place in November 2019 in Chile's capital Santiago, got cancelled. 2020 APEC summit is going to take place in November 2020. 32 APEC summit is going to take place in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. In 2018, during the 30th summit, which took place in Papua New Guinea, for the first time, APEC failed to come out with a joint communique. So far, in all the summits, APEC came out with a joint communique. But for the first time, APEC failed to come out with a joint communique in 2018 during the 30th summit in Papua New Guinea. All the 12 countries except China approved the joint communique. Since China opposed the joint communique could not be released during the 30th APEC summit in 2018. Some basic information related to APEC. In 1989, APEC was established as an intergovernmental forum. APEC is the brainchild of the then Australian Prime Minister Bob Hawke. It consists of 21 Pacific Rim countries. It was meeting for the first time in November 1989 in Australia in a place called as Canberra. The headquarters, that is the secretariat of APEC, happens to be in Singapore. These are the member countries of APEC we have given in the slide. Make a note of the member countries of APEC. 2011, India became the observer of APEC. India wanted to become a member of APEC since 1993, but India was not given membership because India do not have a border with Pacific. Since APEC is open for countries sharing the Pacific, India is not having any border with Pacific, so India is denied entry as a member. However, India is an observer of APEC since 2011. Bogor goals. In 1994, APEC summit took place in Indonesia in a place called as Bogor. In this Bogor summit, they came out with a very important goal called as Bogor goal. The goal is declaration or creation of free and open trade and investment in Asia Pacific by 2010 for the industrialized countries and 2020 for the developing economies. So Bogor goal means APEC declaration to create free and open trade and investment in Asia Pacific by 2020 for the industrialized countries and by 2020 for developing economies. Bogor goal is connected to APEC. Next topic is organization. 20th topic will be Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD. OECD member countries we have given in the map. Kindly see the member countries of OECD on the slide which we have given in the map. OECD came in the news because OECD recently gave a proposal called as Unified Approach, which proposes changes in the taxing rules for the internet giants like Facebook, Apple, Google, Netflix, they and all will be taxed through a new approach called as Unified Approach by OECD. This is a proposal which is why OECD came in the news. Some background information related to OECD. In 1948, Organization for European Economic Cooperation was established. This is the brainchild of Robert Marjolin of France, who was wanting to create this organization to help in the administration of Marshall Plan, which seeks to reconstruct Europe after the World War II. Later in 1961, 18 European countries plus US, Canada, they reformed Organization for European Economic Cooperation into OECD. So the name got changed in 1961 to OECD. Hence the formal establishment of OECD was in 1961. OECD today has 36 member countries. It comprises of world's most advanced countries as well as emerging economies like Mexico, Chile and Turkey. The headquarters of OECD is in Paris, France. On 1st of July 2016, Latvia became a member of OECD. Then in 2018 July, Lithuania became a full member of OECD. May 2018, Colombia signed the accession agreement to become a member of OECD. Some other members who expressed their interest to join OECD are Argentina, Peru, Malaysia, Brazil and Croatia. However, India is not a member of OECD. The three countries, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, they are called as Baltic states. There was a question in the past years of UPSC, Which among the countries come under the category of Baltic states? These are the three countries: Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. They are called as Baltic states.